1, verses 1 through 5, hear now these words from the fourth gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. All things came into being through the Word, and without the Word, nothing came into being. What came into being through the Word was life, and that life was light for all people. The light shines into the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, as we reflect on what it means for you to be love the star, as we reflect on what it means for your light to shine into darkness, God, we ask that you would shine upon us. May your light change us. In your name. Amen. Around 380 BCE, the Greek philosopher Plato wrote The Allegory of the Cave. It was part of his work, Republic, and it became one of the most well-known philosophical pieces of its time. It's still one that is used to teach Greek philosophy today, and it put Plato conversation with Socrates, his mentor. And they set up together this allegory to talk about the importance of education in someone's life. They talked about a group of people who had spent their entire lives chained in a cave, facing the back wall of the cave. All they knew for their entirety of their lives were the iron that held them down, the echoes from conversations happening behind them, where they couldn't make out the words, they could just hear the noises as they bounced off the walls, and the shadows that played up on that back wall of the cave. As light from the sun came into the mouth of the cave, it was broken up by people as they walked in front of it, and finally made its way down to that very back of the cave. The people would spend their entire lives staring at those shadows and listening to the echoes. That was everything they knew. That was their reality. Until one day, one of those shackled found out that his chains were gone. And he was able to get up and experience what happened outside of the cave. As he moved from the back of the cave toward the mouth, he saw the people. He heard what they were saying. He realized that those echoes of sounds that he had heard his entire life, that was actually people talking. He kept going and found himself at the mouth of the cave, staring out into daylight. He walked outside and for the first time in his life experienced the sun and the light and the heat that came off of it. Everything that he had known about his life changed that day as he experienced for the first time the world outside the cave. Well, he went back in and he tried to tell others about his experience so that they might go and so that they might experience it as well. But everyone else who had been prisoners in the cave, when they and to go back into what they knew, what they were comfortable with, the echoes of shadows. But the question is, could they? Could they really, after having experienced the light of the sun, could they go back in the shadows? Could they be content with that reality when they knew something so much better was right outside? Could you? You know, that's the thing about light. Whether it's the sun shining down on you for the first time, or whether it's a candle being lit, light is really good at revealing that which has been in darkness, at revealing that which is hidden from our eyes. Now, this can be helpful, right? I can't tell you how many times I have to get up in the middle of the night on an almost nightly basis, stumble into either James or Joseph's room to calm them down because they're crying, and then go back into my room, and it seems like every time I manage to stub my toe on something or bang my shin on something. I cannot get from my bed to their rooms without hitting something because, well, one, Jess calls me night blind, but also it's just dark, right? If you're sleeping, you want it to be dark. You don't have the lights on. And so I don't turn the light on whenever I go into James's room. And if I don't step my toe on something in his room, usually I step on a Lego. And as you all know, that's way worse than stubbing your toe. I want to just turn on the light so that I can see what's going on. Because light is helpful when you find yourself in darkness. But light can also be painful at times. For that same light that would clear my path to James would also wake him up and make it so that it was hard for him to go back to sleep, which would end up doing more damage to my night than even stepping on a Lego. But light can do more than that, too. For you see, light can reveal those secrets, those hidden things, those fears that we hold, that we are terrified people will find out about. Light reveals that which is in the darkness. And that can be hard for us personally. And that can be hard for us as a community as well. For what light reveals in pointing out our faults, our sin, our brokenness, light also forces us to confront. We see things with which we have to figure out how to deal. And that's not always easy. That's what Isaiah's words are about in chapter 9. As Isaiah talks about a people walking in darkness, having seen a great light, he's trying to give them hope. For they are a people who are living in exile. They are a people who have been removed from their home. They feel disconnected from each other. They know lives of only violence and oppression and injustice. And to these people, Isaiah says, a light is coming. A light is coming that will reveal what the darkness has kept hidden. A light is coming that will confront the brokenness in your lives and will deal with it. And will usher in a time of peace. A time that will make the nation, make the world great again, as only God can do. This was the message to Isaiah's people during the exile, and it's the same message that John, the gospel writer, tries to get across to the New Testament people as well. As he tries to share with them that even though they are not in the exile, they are under the empire, right? And so their lives are one of oppression, of injustice, of violence, of brokenness still. And to these people, John writes that a light is shining. A light is shining that will pierce the darkness, and the darkness will not be able to extinguish it. That's the light that is promised in both the Old Testament in Isaiah and the New Testament in John. That's the life that both peoples during the exile and during the empire needed to hear. And that's the life we are promised of as well. For we're a people that find ourselves walking in darkness as well. We're a people that know that injustice and oppression and violence and war and sin and brokenness are not far away. We hear of it constantly. We see it around us. We experience it in our lives. And to us, as much as to the people of Israel and the Jews in first century Palestine, God promises that a light is coming. A light that will reveal. A light that will confront. And a life that will overcome the brokenness of sin in this world. That is what we are promised in Christ, and that is what we receive. And we, as an Advent people, as a people of that light, we have the great pleasure of being bearers of that light to the world. After we have experienced it, we have the great pleasure of walking alongside Christ in the work is happening. As the light goes where the darkness is, as the light goes where brokenness is, reveals it, confronts it, and overcomes it, we have the opportunity of joining in that work, of being the light ourselves as Christ shines through us. This isn't always easy. In fact, sometimes it might even be painful. But it is always good work. And it is world-changing work. The story goes that on this day, as the gladiators were getting ready to fight in the Colosseum, everyone in Rome was coming in attendance. The story goes that this was going to be the fight to end all gladiator fights, as it was people's champion versus people's champion. It seemed like no one in the audience could lose with this fight, as they were seeing the greatest gladiators of their time go at one another. And the Colosseum was packed. There was not an empty spot in the house, much less an empty seat, as everyone wanted to come and be a part of witnessing history on this day. Caesar himself was in attendance to watch this match. And as the gladiators started their bout, as they started exchanging hit after hit, it seemed like no one was going to be able to come out ahead. But they were evenly matched. People in the audience cheering on their champion started wondering if we're ever going to get to leave. For it seemed like no one was going to get the upper hand. Until finally, through sheer dumb luck, one of the gladiators stepped back, slipped on a rock, and lost his footing for just a second. But the other one was able to take advantage of that, knock the other one's sword away, and hold him at sword point. Clearly, the victor. He didn't take what was his yet, for he knew the rules. He knew the rules was that the only person who had the decision over life and death in the Colosseum was Caesar. And so he looked up to Caesar and waited for Caesar to give him a command. And Caesar did what Caesar was supposed to do. He stood up regally from his seat. He walked to the end of his balcony and waited. He waited because he knew that this was as much about those in the audience as it was about him. You see, this was Caesar's chance to gain favor from the audience. So he waited as everyone in attendance jumped on their feet and started screaming to Caesar, trying to convince him to do what they wanted him to do. For you see, Caesar had two options here. Caesar could either extend his hand and put his thumb up as a way of saying, mercy, the gladiator fought well and deserves to live to fight another day. Or across his throat, telling the champion to take what was his. The audience was yelling, screaming, trying to convince him, hoping beyond hope that if they just thought hard enough, they could be the one to help Caesar make the decision. Everyone was standing, everyone was screaming, everyone was focused on the emperor. Everyone, that is, except for a little monk named Telemachus, who was sitting at the very top of the Colosseum, praying. As everyone is screaming, Telemachus stands up, takes a breath, and in a quiet voice says, "In the name of God, stop." Now, no one heard him. Everyone is screaming and yelling and not paying attention at all to this short little man at the very top of the Colosseum. But Telemachus walks to the stairs, takes a step down, and says again, "In the name of God, stop." Finally, those nearest him see this monk and stop yelling, trying to figure out what it is he's doing. He again takes a step down and says these six words, "In the name of God, stop." Other people start paying attention. They start elbowing those next to them and pointing to this little monk, trying to figure out what it is he's doing and why he's not shouting to Caesar like everyone else is. And silence starts to make its way all the way around the Colosseum as Telemachus continues to take a step down, and a step down, and a step down, saying every time, "In the name of God, stop." Finally, he steps onto the very sand of the Colosseum, walks to the gladiators, who at this point are standing bewildered. They don't know what's going on. The one who had clearly lost has picked up his sword, but doesn't do anything with it because he's bewildered. He has no idea what's going on. Telemachus stands between the two gladiators, puts a hand on either of their shoulders, looks straight up at Caesar, and says one last time, "In the name of God, stop." And Caesar makes his decision. Hand and crosses his throat. And the two gladiators run Telemachus through, killing him on the spot. Over here, Dad gathers his family in a quiet room. Here, a group of businessmen get their things and they make their way out as well. Here, a group of 50, here, a group of 100, here, a group of 200, until finally, everyone is filing out of the Colosseum, and the only ones left in their spots are Caesar and his guards, and the two gladiators standing on either side of the body of Telemachus. That was the last time there was a fight to the death in the Roman Colosseum. Telemachus changed the world by bringing the light of Christ into a place of darkness and brokenness. It was costly.